now.
We're here with Staff Sergeant First Class Holland, and he's with the 3rd ID, and we wanted to ask him how things have changed over the past since you've been here. This is your second tour. You've been in Afghanistan as well. Thank you for your service. Let's tell me about then, and let's hear about Iraq now. We're in the heart of Iraq. We're in the middle of Baghdad.
Iraq has changed a lot. I think from the past in OIF 20405, what happened was is the government didn't really didn't have a control. We were still fighting, you know, trying to get a democracy government going in here, and it was undecided. But now, over the past 8 years, it's gone a long way. We've noticed a decrease in like violence and all that stuff. The Iraqis have started their own security force. The Iraqi police are starting to do more. The IA's, Iraqi Army, they're all stepped up, and it's starting to work a lot better.
What is the counter for that change? You're saying the Iraqis have stepped up. It's 2010 now, but back in 2007, when the surge was going on, people were talking about this was the end of the world. I mean, what do you think has changed over the past 3-4 years?
I just think that everyone, that the Americans started, you know, they helped train them, and they started getting all together and stuff like that, and they just took off with it. The Iraqi government has done really good. They started their own democracy, and the IAs and the IPs, they're doing really good with the security of their own country.
This is your second time here, and you've been in Afghanistan as well.
Yes.
It seems like sometimes in the media that there's a battle between Afghanistan and Iraq, and one gets more attention than the other. Is Iraq neglected right now? It's 2010. Are we talking about Iraq as much as we should back home?
Yeah, I think we are. I mean, there's still a threat and danger still here, but Afghanistan, same way.
I've been to Afghanistan as well. I've been here as well. What for you, what's some of the differences between Afghanistan and here in Iraq?
Afghanistan was a lot of mountains, humping up a lot of mountains, a lot of gear. And here we just, it's more flat land and more walking, and that's pretty much all I can say about that.
What don't people back home in the United States know about Iraq?
I don't think they see the positive of what the army and the military itself is doing here. I think they take it's like for granted. They don't see all the stuff that's going in. But right now, the military and the Iraqi government, we've come together. We're like a cohesion, and it's really working out. I think this country's going to go far.
Thank you very much.
Okay, no problem.
And we're talking to Major Moser here, who has been here twice, and he's going to tell us about some of the differences you've seen in the country since the last time you were here.
All right, the first time I was here was got here in the first initial push up to Baghdad in 2003, and I'm back over here now as advisor on a transition team. And I would tell you that I've seen a tremendous difference as far as when I got here. You know, there was not an Iraqi army, there was an Iraqi army, and now 2010, the Iraqi army is fully capable of doing pretty much everything. They're securing their nation, and that's what it's all about. So I've seen a big change. It's a big change.
Yeah, you work in combat logistics, and now our situation with combat, we're not handling, as far as I know, combat ops as much before. Our troops are not exposed as much as they were in the past. Is that one of the differences you've noticed?
I wouldn't say that. I mean, we're still the best trained army in the world, but as far as just, you know, we as far as having to train an army, that's something that we don't do on a regular basis. So, you know, we mainly train for, you know, total conventional warfare, and then whenever we have to rebuild a nation, and you're talking about rebuilding infrastructures from, you know, basically light fixtures so they have power sources, to, you know, having to build a whole army, you know, that takes, you know, basically training, and it takes a lot of effort, something that we don't normally train for.
It's a lot of things we take for granted back home. What don't people back home know about Iraq that you know, that since you've been here twice now?
I'll tell you that there are strong people that I'll give you an example. Being a combat advisor, I'm up in Mosul, Iraq, and the average citizen in Iraq has about 4 hours of power, 2 hours in the morning, 2 hours in the evening, and things just like having air conditioner or having refrigeration in America we take for granted, and here, you know, that's something that's like, you know, only the very, very rich have those type of necessities, and well, not even necessity, but have those kind of luxuries rather. And I would say don't take that kind of stuff for granted in the United States. Well, a lot of times we do. And here in Iraq, they got some strong soldiers, and they survive off of little or nothing. And most of them want to make this their country. All of them want to make their country a better place, and we're here to continue to try to help them make it a better place to live.
How are your troops and the troops that you observe that are under your command or around you, how are they taking their time here in Iraq?
We're persevering. Morale is high. I'll tell you, from 2003 to now, I remember living outside for the first 5 months, and now we're living in air-conditioned, you know, container housing units, like whatever they call them, you choose. And I would tell you that the American taxpayer dollar is being well spent.
One of the things I keep seeing and hearing from the troops that we've been talking to, and I've been talking to troops at random, just picking people left and right, is that a lot of them don't feel that what they've seen in the media and the news back home is reflected here in their realities. And so that's a big difference from what we back home on our television screens are getting, and the message and the experience they're having here, living it live on the ground. So I hope that you enjoyed talking to some of our troops just as much as I did. This is Matt Sanchez. We're in Baghdad and with troopathon.org.
And we are here in Baghdad, Iraq, where it's a nice roasty toasty, at least 125 degrees today. But we have some amazing coincidences that happened in our week here. Too many of them to be able to tell you, but you know, it's amazing that you can come clear around the world and make connections with people who had connections with your family. Wait till you hear this one. It is a small world. We had interviewed earlier Staff Sergeant Ruiz, and as I was walking back through the USO, he flagged me down to let me know that he actually had amazing connection, and I'd just like him to share a little bit about that.
In 2004, I believe it was 2004, your son was in Quantico, Virginia, shooting an exercise with the Marine Corps rifle pistol team. And so I actually remembered your son, and I didn't put two and two together. I actually had kind of leaned over to my captain and had asked, hey, is that his mom? And he said he didn't know. And then when you had left, you know, after speaking to him, he came to me and said, yeah, that's his mom. And I was like, hey, you know, sir, I actually shot with her son when we were at, you know, Quantico, Virginia. So we had a nice little exercise together. It wasn't a, you know, a real long day, but you know, I got to experience him. I got to meet him. I got to meet his team. Awesome, awesome guys, awesome team, very passionate about what they do. And that's the one thing about, you know, Marines really, truly respect Navy SEALs because they're awesome. They're awesome at what they do. They're extreme professionals. And, you know, it's just it was just neat to actually see you and go, wow, that's his mom. So.
Well, thank you. It is a small world, but I think you're kind of a rare breed, too. When we interviewed you earlier, we see here that you've got the U.S. Army patch on, but we find out that you are truly once a Marine, always Marine. Is that correct?
Yes, ma'am. I was a Marine. I came in the Marine Corps in 1989, and I was got out of the Marine Corps in 1996. I came back in the Marine Corps in 2002, and from there on, I stayed in all the way until 2007 when the United States Army asked me to try out for the U.S. shooting team. So at first I was kind of insulted only because, you know, once a Marine, always Marine. And I'm still a Marine in my heart and my soul. I'm passionate about the Army. I like what I do now. But, you know, that, like they say, that saying, once a Marine, always Marine. So at the time, I didn't really know what I was going to do. I knew that at the time I was on the Marine Corps pistol team, thoroughly enjoying what I was doing. And then we got orders to leave, because when you're on the Marine Corps pistol team, you're only allowed to stay there 3 years. So, you know, the Army kept on bugging me, saying they wanted me to try out. And I talked with my wife, and we prayed, and we cried, and prayed, and cried. And finally, it came down that it was the right decision. And so I crossed over. I did the Blue to Green program in 2007, December 21st. And December 22nd, I was a United States soldier.